Well, again, we're continuing in our fantastic journey through the Bible. We've been at it for a year. We've managed to get up to part 19. Finally, into the story of Joseph. The story of Joseph takes a great big part of the book of Genesis. We'll look at Joseph for 3 weeks because it's such a big story. But it's interesting, as I think about this, for all that Joseph takes up in the book of Genesis, he almost disappears afterwards. You know, they talk in the Bible about the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They don't talk about the God of Joseph. When you hear about the big tribes, the major tribes of the nation of Israel that come descended from Jacob, you don't hear about Joseph because there actually is no tribe of Joseph. In fact, our scripture reading earlier was one of the few when you have seen mention of Joseph, that's one of the very few places where Joseph is really referred to afterwards. He kind of disappears off into the woodwork. But his story here in Genesis is filled with great things for us to learn. It's a magnificent, majestic story that doesn't start that way. We can learn a lot from Joseph. We can learn a lot from his personal experience, both the positive stuff and the negative stuff. And that's what we're going to do over the next little while. Last week we looked at his father Jacob, and we looked at how God remained faithful to him, even through 20 years of hardship that was caused in part by his own sin and in part by the sins of other people that he had to live with and deal with. The importance of understanding that hardship in life is not an indication that God has abandoned us. And that cannot be overstated, because very few people will live lives without hardship. Anybody here never have hardship of some kind in life? Of course we have. Hardship can come in our lives for many reasons. In fact, it should be expected at some point in our lives, and it may be for a long stretch in our lives. The important thing is to know that God is always with you. God doesn't promise to save us from hardship, but he does promise to carry us through hardship. And this is clearly demonstrated in the life of Joseph. That's what I want us to look at. We're going to sort of skim over a lot of stuff in his life because there's so much we can't look at it in detail. But the things that we want to look at in his life, we want us to realize that Joseph really started out living kind of a charmed life. He had it all, if you like. Joseph was, his father was a wealthy man. Joseph was his father's favorite son. Anybody here their parents' favorite? I know I was. if you're not an only child, and you say you're the favorite, okay, we need to have a talk, because we know we're right. He was a favorite child. If you look in Genesis chapter 37, verse 3, we read these words: Israel, that is Jacob, he loved Joseph more than all his sons, because Joseph had been born in Israel's old age. So he made Joseph a special robe with long sleeves, or what we commonly know as the coat of many colors. He gave him that special coat that brought about the name of that Andrew Lloyd Webber miracle, the Technicolor Dream Coat. Joseph, not only was he born in Jacob's old age, but he was also the son of Jacob's favorite wife. Remember, he had two wives and two concubines. He had children by all four. But Rachel was the one he really loved. Rachel had been barren. Jacob had fathered many children through his other wife Leah, through his two concubines, but Rachel had no children. And then finally Rachel was able to conceive, and Joseph was born. So special to Jacob, especially when you consider that as time went on, Rachel died. Joseph was the reminder to Jacob of his dear and beloved wife. He was the favorite. also appears that he was, even though he was the 11th born son, it seems that he actually had been given the status of the firstborn son. Now, we've talked about what that means before. As the firstborn, son, you are the one who inherits the head of the position, the head of the family. You become the patriarch of the family, and you get a double portion of all the inheritance. So Jacob's estate would be divided up into pieces, and the firstborn gets the double portion compared to everybody else. See, Reuben was the actual firstborn, but Reuben had messed up. Reuben had sinned badly against his father, and he lost his status. Now, it doesn't really tell us anywhere that Joseph had been given that position as firstborn, except when we go on later on, we find that when we look at the tribes of Israel, I mentioned this before, if you look at the 12 tribes of Israel, each one named after one of the sons of Israel, of Jacob, you find there is no tribe of Joseph. There's a tribe of Reuben, the fallen son. There's a tribe of Judah. There's a tribe of Levi. There's each one of them. But you don't find the tribe of Joseph. But what you do find is the tribe of Manasseh, and you find the tribe of Ephraim. Now, neither of them are sons of Jacob. They are the sons of Joseph. So two tribes out of Joseph. That's the double portion, showing that Joseph had been given that special status, the important status, as the firstborn son, even though he was, in fact, the 11th born. Now, if we come into chapter 37 of Genesis, where that video took place, and we see all these things happening with Joseph, we read about Joseph bringing a bad report about his brothers, the brothers of the concubines. You know, being brothers, the sons of the concubines may have had a little bit lower status because they weren't sons of actual wives of Joseph. And Joseph brings a bad report to his father about them. Yeah, picture this. Joseph is probably about 17 years old, younger than all his brothers. And in all likelihood, Jacob has set him up to be their supervisor. And when Joseph brings the report, it's because Jacob probably wanted to know what was going on, and he wanted to hear it from the supervisor. Anybody ever had a job? You've been in the job for a long time, and suddenly if somebody appointed over you as your supervisor who's young and inexperienced and new to the company, and they're a know-it-all, and they're kind of, yeah, well, I'm going to tell about, have you ever experienced a person like that? Just drives you crazy, right? Well, that's what the brothers had to do with this young 17-year-old supervisor. And not only was he young and a supervisor and a little bit, a tattletale-ish kind of guy, but he wore a badge of honor that none of them had. He wore that technicolor dream coat everywhere. He got that, and no one else did. I mean, everywhere he went, he wore a big flashing neon sign that said, "I am Dad's favorite." Too bad for you. One Bible commentator said this was a coat reaching to the hands and feet, worn by persons not much occupied with manual labor. In other words, while the other brothers are all slaving away, tending the flocks, and there's Joseph sitting down in the supervisor's chair saying, "You, come on, get to work. Didn't go over very well. He had it made. Not only did he have it made with Dad, the next thing you know, it seems that God is doing things. You see, because he had these special dreams. God was giving him special dreams. And it was showing that Joseph was going to be elevated to a position above all, even higher above all his brothers, higher than his father, higher than his mother. They're all going to be bowing down to him. He had it. Life was just charmed. He had this career path laid out. It was all good. Now, we can start to feel like the brothers about Joseph, this spoiled rat of a kid. But you know, Joseph really was a good person. See, he wasn't only living a charmed life because of the position and the money and the wealth and the divine blessings, but really he had a godly upbringing too. He really did have a good upbringing. See, his father Jacob had learned an awful lot in his years in exile, and he had come back to God, and he had become himself a godly man, and he raised his son to be a godly man. When we look at, if you read through the story of what Joseph is like when he's living in Egypt, we find he's a man of tremendously good character. He's honest. In fact, he's so honest that he is consistently entrusted with the care of everything. And everything that he does prospers because he's honest. This guy who wore the supervisor's coat and didn't have to work, we find that he's hardworking. We find that he's faithful to God. We find that he's a man who trusts God. He's a man of character. He may have been immature when he was dealing with his brothers early on. Yeah, he was immature, but by all accounts, he's what we would call a good person. Now, we generally like to think that good things happen to good people and bad things happen to bad people, right? Isn't that the way it's supposed to be? You know, there are actually Christian preachers who will pretty much teach that very thing, aren't they? You know, but it really isn't true. That's a Hindu way of thinking called karma, and it's not a Christian way. You can be the best person, you can be blessed by God in all kinds of ways, you can experience every blessing, and life can start to fall apart. And it's important that we understand that. Your faithfulness to God does not guarantee that God is going to bring endless good to your life. You've heard of the prosperity gospel, and there's some very popular TV preachers who preach what's called the prosperity gospel, that if you're faithful to God, you're going to experience material blessing and you're going to experience good health. It's not true. It is not true. It doesn't matter how many times you're on Facebook and you hit like on this particular prayer. It doesn't mean that God is going to bless you. That's nonsense. You can be the most faithful Christian and experience all kinds of suffering, and it's no indication that God has failed you. In Joseph's life is an example of that. From the charmed life that he lived, suddenly his life, in a flash, goes sour. It just goes sour. You see, his brothers didn't take well to all the things that of Joseph's blessed, charmed life. In fact, they were jealous and they were resentful. And what did they do? Just what all of us would do with our siblings if we could, right? They sold them into slavery. Nobody ever want to sell their brother or sister into slavery? She said, at times I would have sold my brother for a quarter if I could have. I love my brother. But you know, sibling rivalry, right? I'm sure he would have sold me if he did. The bad report, special code, the favored position, the special dreams. Genesis 37:4 tells us Joseph's brothers saw that their father loved him more than any of them, and they hated Joseph. And they couldn't speak to him on friendly terms. You talk about sibling rivalry. He's got 11 brothers against him. It wasn't good. Verse 8 goes on and says, then his brothers asked him, after these dreams, what, are you going to be king? You're going to be our king or rule us? And they hated him even more because of his dreams and his words. Verse 11 says, so his brothers were jealous of him. But his father kept thinking about these things. And verse 18 says, they saw him from a distance, and before he reached them, they plotted to kill him. Great relationship. That's the state of the man with the charmed life. They sell Joseph into slavery, and claim to go back to their father and say, he was killed by a wild animal. We don't know what to do. Have any of you seen the movie 12 Years a Slave? Powerful, powerful movie about a man back in the days of slavery in the United States. He was a free man in the northern states, the United States. He was stolen away by some crooked people and sold into slavery. A free man sold into slavery where he endured unbelievable hardship, of course, as any person would who was a slave, particularly with some cruel slave owners. This was Joseph's experience. A blessed man suddenly sold into slavery. He sold to a man named Potiphar. Potiphar was a powerful man, but Joseph, because of his character and the blessing of God on his life, he earns his master's trust, and he's elevated to become the chief steward of his house. And he's running his master's house. And he's entrusted with absolutely everything. Everything suddenly seems to be going well. And where I got the title from this message, no good deed goes unpunished, that's what happens to Joseph. Everything is going well, you know, maybe it's not so bad being a slave, it's not exactly what I want, but I can deal with this when I'm running the household, and all of a sudden Potiphar's wife sees him and says, oh, good looking guy, hey, you, come here, I got plans for you, and they were not honorable plans. You get the picture. Joseph tries as hard as he can to be as faithful to his master as possible. He will not touch his master's wife. Even if he could get away with it, he wants to honor God, he wants to honor his master. What does that end up happening? When she gives up trying to seduce him, she accuses him of trying to rape her. And from his elevated position, bang, down again. He's thrown into prison. And I tell you, we used to joke when I was working with a chaplain in the provincial system, we used to talk about, you know, different prisons like Club Fed, you know, saying how some of these prisons were easy. Well, there was nothing easy about ancient prisons. They were dungeons, and they were awful. Nothing's going right for him. But Joseph continues to remain faithful. He continues to remain faithful, and he becomes a trustee prisoner. He's now assisting the jailer. In fact, it reaches the point where he's given the care over all of the prisoners. He's put in charge. Prisoners are running the jailhouse because he could be trusted. Two high-ranking officials are suddenly thrown into jail with him. Baker and the cupbearer, I wonder why are they so important, but given their positions of trust, they displeased Pharaoh and they're thrown into the prison and they have dreams. They're very concerned about the dreams, and Joseph, who could say, I don't care about anybody, why should I care about anybody? Nobody cares about me, why should I care about you? But no, he doesn't. He says to them, tell me your dreams, and I'll interpret them for you. Well, actually, he doesn't say, I will interpret them for you. He says, God will interpret them for you. He interprets the dreams. He says to the cupbearer, hey, good news. Pharaoh's going to restore you to your position. Baker, not such good news. Sorry. Cupbearer, of course, is happy. He's restored to his position. He says, Joseph asks, please, I'm here unjustly, unfairly. Please speak to Pharaoh on my behalf. The cupbearer promises, absolutely, I'll do that for you. I owe you this. For 2 years, the cupbearer forgot all about Joseph. 2 more years, Joseph languished in that dungeon. In spite of his good deeds, no good deed goes unpunished. Until finally, Pharaoh himself has a dream. No one can interpret it. All of a sudden, the cupbearer remembers. But that's for another story. We'll deal with that in 2 weeks, because we're back in holidays. No good deed goes unpunished. From charmed life to sold into slavery. From elevated up because of his good character to crashing down. Everything seems, no matter what he does, everything seems to go wrong. What can we learn from Joseph's life? As I looked at it, there are a few things that jumped out of my mind that we've got to remember. That Joseph can teach us. The first I've already talked about. Being a good or godly person is not a guarantee of an easy life. In fact, it can result in the exact opposite. It can create jealousy, it can create opposition. The Bible, in fact, tells us that, in fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Not may be persecuted, not might be persecuted, but will be persecuted. So if you think that godliness and faithfulness is a guarantee of an easy life, don't listen to those preachers who say it is. The Bible teaches us otherwise. Joseph's life was an illustration of that simple. Secondly, when we do enjoy worldly privilege, like Joseph did, we better do so with humility. When we're living with those who don't enjoy the same things. You see, Joseph was blessed, he had a charmed life, but he managed to rub his brothers the wrong way. He did cause some of his own problems because of his immaturity. We cannot afford to be immature. We cannot afford to lord it over people. We cannot afford to gloat with people. You see, there's no such thing as a self-made man or a self-made woman. If you have material blessings, if you have that charmed life, if you have all those good things, it's not because you're special. It's not because of the things that you did in spite of everyone else. You have been blessed. Remember, Moses wrote, said to the Israelites, remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your forefathers, as it is today. Anything that you have in your life, any good thing that you have in life, has come from the hand of God. And it is by his grace, it is not because you deserve it. It's because of God's grace. Therefore, we have no reasonable choice but to live humbly with others. We are not better than someone else. In fact, we have to be sure that we don't make judgments about people who are in difficult places. Look at Joseph. When you look at Joseph, you know, in the situation that he was in, where he was a prisoner, he was a slave, how easy it would be to pass judgment on him. But it wasn't his doing. Circumstances went against him, and suddenly from height to depth. We can be very quick to pass judgment on people. There are many people who are victims of all kinds of circumstances. I remember Donna, when she was working for the parole board, she would look at files of people who were coming up for parole, and some of the stories of these people, some of the people who committed horrific crimes, and you know, we would look at them and say, oh, what scum, what animals, they deserve this, that, the other thing. And as she would read through these files, and she'd read some of their stories, and one thing she would often say was, this person never had a chance. I don't know if you've seen on television a commercial by an organization called Raising the Roof. Shows a family, seem to have it all, happy family. Dad comes home, he's lost his job. life suddenly starts just sinking. You can't find a new job. Money, bills are piling up. And now they're fighting at home. The kids are getting angry. Next thing you know, the repo man's coming and taking away the TV and the computer and the car. And before you know it, they're living in their car. They've lost their house. It'd be easy to pass judgment on people if we only saw them living in the car. You know the story that went behind them. Just like Joseph. It's not our place to make judgments. Another important thing to remember about Joseph, that we see that for all that went through him, so we can maintain godly character even when things go wrong. There are times when we just say, why bother? What's the point? What's it getting me? Joseph had more opportunity to say, why am I staying faithful? Why am I staying true? Why am I staying honest? It's really messing me up, but he didn't do that. He didn't do that. The psalmist in Psalm 73 wrote, surely in vain have I kept my heart pure. In vain have I washed my hands in innocence. All day long I have been plagued. I have been punished every morning. Why am I bothering? Look at, goes on and talks about, but look at the sinners. They seem to have it all. As we'll see when we go on in Joseph's story, it's because he maintained his integrity. It's because he maintained his godly character that the story goes in the wonderful, powerful direction it goes. You see, it was Joseph's faithfulness that made him usable by God and allowed him to enjoy the ultimate reward that he would have otherwise lost. The same is true for us. Remember, God doesn't promise to save us from hardship, but he does promise to carry us through hardship. And as we'll see, when he does that, he can use us for wonderful, wonderful things. He did with Joseph. He can with each of us. God is faithful. He's calling us to be faithful. He will use us for that. No good deed unpunished. In the end, God will reward us in ways far greater, far outweigh anything negative that could ever happen in our lives. Let's just remain faithful as Joseph did.